I'd say one of the things about being in the accessibility community is you get to meet great people and work with great people like Ben and George. People who are in accessibility tend to be quite passionate, as you probably notice. My name's Abby James. I wear numerous hats. Officially, I'm here at AbilityNet, but actually, my journey into the understanding of these regulations actually started when I was an employee at University of Southampton as an accessibility researcher. And I also sit on the WCAG committees for the guidelines and the European Disability Forum. So I'm sort of in standards and regulations hat. And whenever I'm talking, I seem to always start with this slide, which is accessibility is a journey, not a destination. So my journey with these regulations actually started, I think it was about March 2017, when I had a phone call with one of Richard's predecessors and said, A, is this going to happen? And B, does it cover universities? 2.5 years later, I think we're there with the second question. The first one, definitely. But that's just the process. It's always a bit of untangling. But I also like to say accessibility is a journey because technology always changes. Standards change. So it's always keeping in mind that this isn't something that is necessarily a task and finished job. I sort of hear that word, it's about thinking about building this in for the future and really hopefully in the graveyard slot at the end of the day, I can give you some things to think about for the long term and the future. But if you're going on a journey like this into the clouds, into the hills, you always have to think about a few things. You normally have a purpose, even if it's just, I want to go for a drive in the hills. You need some direction. You need to know where you're going. You need some organisation, even if it's just, do I have enough fuel in the car? Or is it, you know, have I remembered my laptop charger and things like that? And you tend to need some safety features, you need seat belts, make sure your car's okay. So when you're on that journey, you need to think about things. And with accessibility, it's exactly the same. But actually, what we need is objectives and strategy, policies and procedures. Yes, we have these regulations. Yes, it's something we should have been doing anyway under the Equality Act. Yes, we have these wonderful standards that are very complex. Even the people who write them admit they are very complex to understand and convoluted, and they're not necessarily easy to test and to follow. And there's always work to improve that. But in essence, we also need to be thinking about the framework of making sure we are embedding this within digital landscapes and estates and anything we do. And the thing is, that involves anyone who's procuring, designing, creating or editing digital platforms. I'm aware, unfortunately, I had to sort of pop out and do another training session over lunchtime, so I missed the panel, but I understand there was discussions about procurement. But it touches everyone, and having been in university life, I know that is really quite a daunting challenge. And also, we've already heard about the Equality Act, but in the essence of a university landscape, we've also got the other thing of inclusive teaching and learning. So over the last few years, we've also seen the government being pushing for us to adapt more inclusive teaching and learning, to embed more support when we are working with students with different needs and different backgrounds and through widening participation. So when we're talking about digital accessibility, we can't just treat it as a technical, okay, we've reached the standards. We need to think about actually, well, how are we teaching? Are we using lecture capture because we think it's more inclusive, but is that actually creating more barriers as well? Are we using more collaborative tools during our teaching, polling systems, but are they more accessible? So it's all overlapping, it's not a single thing. And I think we've already touched on that this is many internal sites, external sites, third-party tools as well. So the thing is, this is all quite scary. For those of you particularly, as like Fiona said, it's like less than 12 months since she knew about this and she's already organised a conference on it and been involved with launching a toolkit. It's quite a journey, but it's something we can embrace. And it can lead to a wider culture change. So essentially, you know, this is a big stick, potentially, this regulations. But actually, these statements are about, accessibility statements, are about increased transparency. As somebody who does audits, I can tell you, I can do any page, I'll find something. It might just be a little typo in one of your little hidden labels in your code, but there'll always be an accessibility issue. There's always something we can improve, essentially on the usability accessibility side. And so we shouldn't be scared of being transparent about what accessibility we support, where we do need a bit of help, and where we need to plan for the future. As somebody who uses assistive technology, who, you know, hates PDFs because I can't change the fonts, anybody who said about PDFs, yeah, I can't change the font style. That is a barrier for me. I want to know if you always offer PDFs, or can I just have an alternative download? Can I have an EPUB? Can I have an HTML version instead? If I know that up front, I can set my own expectations and not spend half an hour drilling down into a library system and then going, oh, okay, let's get out the OCR software and start breaking the PDF. It also will lead to increased public and student expectations. So while this is only about the public sector at the moment, there is a move globally for more of this regulation to be applied to private sector. Ignoring the B word, European Accessibility Act is going to apply to e-commerce and e-books and e-banking. So they are going to be applying all these standards that we're dealing with to any of those e-platforms, and we would expect also to see it in other countries. We already see it like in Norway, where they fine companies that don't meet accessibility standards. So essentially, as a member of the public applying to the university, I might be going, oh, hang on, I'm going to look at your statement. I'm going to see what you're doing. I want to know that you're embracing accessibility and going to make it easier. And likewise, while it might seem a big cost to be fixing these accessibility issues and testing them and maintaining them, there is the other side of that. And actually, at the moment, you as a university are having to do a lot of individual support for students with disabilities. And the government is reducing their funding for that. So actually, your manpower hours of supporting a relatively small group of students is huge. But actually, by changing expectations and improving digital accessibility across the board, actually, you're supporting a wider range of students at the same level of cost, potentially. So there is a culture change coming. And there is also increased reputational risk, you know, like George has just shown. Who wants to be in that nice, what's it, 23? Or the other 600 plus that don't have a statement. So we will start to see accessibility as something that is being measured across the industry. And while monitoring is not the role of the Office of Students, the Office of Students are very aware of these regulations and are considering what role they will have. And there are groups like I do, representing disabled students, who will be saying, hang on, what are we doing about accessibility? So a question I often ask when I'm in sessions like this, so I wake you all up at the end. Does anybody in the room know what happens in your organisation if somebody sends an email saying I've got an accessibility problem? Hang on, put your hands up. Hang on, Michelle, I know, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, ooh, 7, ooh, might get to 10%. Yeah, that's about normal. And that's one fundamental question you have to have answered for your accessibility statement. And that is a really big question for a big organisation. Who is going to be responsible? And who is going to be responsible might differ between your public-facing website, a department intranet, and somebody who happens to be teaching Computer Science 101. It's Computer Science 101 needs to be the person who is responsible for that content. How do we go through that? What happens when you ask somebody to deal with that accessibility problems? This is the typical reaction. Denial. It can't be important. No one complains. People don't use assistive technology with our site. Absolutely. I go into organisations, I go to app developers, I go to private companies, universities. No. We look at our visitor stats. Nobody uses assistive technology. You have no idea. You have no idea who is going to be using it, whether it's somebody like Addy or whether it's somebody who just wants to use it on their phone who can't read it because the font is too small. Anger. Not my problem. Don't tell me how to do my job. It's that framework. He said it was accessible. No, I bought those components, they're fine. Bargaining, oh, developers love hacks. I can do a hack, having to do it properly. Yeah, we'll tweak the CSS, we'll be fine. Then they get to WCAG, and they get this page. And it's like, how many standards? what do you expect me to do? Why do I have to worry about headings? There you are, you know. Finally, hopefully, when they've calmed down, okay, we can see what needs to be done and we're working on a strategy. I know you're not expecting it by next week, let's be sensible, but we are working on a strategy. So actually, those five stages, which might be sort of reminiscent to you if you've ever had to go to somebody with any type of issues, any type of technical issues particularly, but happens in accessibility. And there is a link on these slides that will take you to the report where this model was put forward about 10 years ago, actually matches your typical change curve, Kubler-Ross change curve. It's also the five stages of grief. It matches as well. So if you're into your psychology, you might have recognised that. And accessibility acceptance requires change management. So essentially, everybody in this room who's probably thinking, oh my God, I've heard all of this, and it's got to be done by Monday, how am I going to do it? This is not a one-person job in any organisation. We can highlight corporates who are world leaders on embedding accessibility, and they will have senior managers engaged, they will have middle managers responsible, and they will have it in everybody's job description, but it's still work they have to do day in, day out to highlight it. So it needs to be embedded through management, it needs to make sure that improvements are sustainable. An accessibility audit only tells you that your site is accessible at that time, on that date, using that bit of equipment and that browser. It doesn't mean it will carry on being fixed when somebody presses publish on the next page. It needs to be monitored effectively and realistically as well. And there are processes and tools for doing that, and there are mechanisms. And that means upskilling people in-house as well as looking out of house as well. And making sure you meet the legal and policy requirements, and you know, use this as a bit of a stick in your organisation. Make sure it's up the priority list. So I think the key thing is this is not just a technical challenge. When you are talking about culture change, when you're talking about embedding responsibilities, this can't be just done by the developers. It can't just be done by somebody who's within IT. It needs to engage the whole organisation, which is incredibly daunting in a university. So how can we embed accessibility within an organisation? This is just some examples of the type of models people have used, both in private and public sector. Ooh. My link hasn't worked very well then. So involved with culture change. This is just one model that's used with culture change, and it has been used with inclusion, diversity and accessibility. It's the McKinsey 7S framework. And the reason why I like to refer to this is because it really sort of engages in all the things that you need to do if you're doing culture change. And particularly, I like this model because it starts off with shared values. And we have shared values already set externally in a university. We have the Equality Act, we have the Web Accessibility Regulations, and usually within a university you have an inclusion policy or sometimes an access statement as well. So you already know what you should be achieving, but these are all the things you are going to have to think about within an organisation to do that. And systems is only 1/7 of that. So systems is only the IT bit, skills is another 1/7 of that. So you need to think about staff, you need to think about the style, what standards are you going to go to? How quickly are you going to achieve accessibility standards? Who is going to be responsible for it? What are the lines of management? And how is that measured at a strategic level? Is it on your boards? Is it in your senates or whatever governance that this is going to be monitored? Because if it's not there, it ain't going to happen all the way for the next 5-10 years. So we need for leadership and strategy. And in 2016, Forrester Marketing Research did some work with Microsoft, and they surveyed about 320 organizations, and I found this report that was really useful to pull out. So they were talking about accessible technologies, talking about assistive technology and accessible web technologies within organizations, particularly looking at employment, but I think it's got some really useful lessons for us in the university sector. So the organisations that found it helped boost adoption, they identified the key actions were clear executive leadership for accessibility initiatives, showcasing success of accessibility initiatives. So like Ken's examples, they can do it. This works in one department. Can we transfer that to other areas of our organisation as well? Build partnerships with key stakeholders. That Lexis website it's a website that's been there for actually about 10 years. And we're like, okay, we've got all these resources. We need to put them somewhere. Can we bring them all together? So there are ways of engaging with different key stakeholders as well across the sector. Learn from your peers in sectors and others. This is still relatively new in the university and public sector. Public sector is so diverse, you know, comparing NHS to a small HE or FE institution is different ends of the spectrum, but we can learn from each other, and we can also learn from the private sector and internationally as well, because this isn't just the UK doing this, this is actually the whole of Europe doing this, so we are able to reach out to other countries as well. Put accessibility criteria into your technology procurement process. You've heard it already, but make sure it's in there and make sure your procurement processes absolutely define what you mean and what your acceptance criteria are. There are so many websites I've looked at where they said, oh, well, they said they were developing to WCAG 2. I've not done that. So when they achieved those types of, when they looked at those actions and they used them to boost the adoptions, they recognised a wide range of benefits for having an accessibility strategy. Now, this slide is a screenshot. It's not duly accessible. But in the speaker notes, I'll put my hand up, in the speaker notes is the description. But I'm just going to pull out some main points from it to describe it to you. So they did some lots of statements, and they asked public and private sector to measure them. The ones with the red boxes are public sector over 75%. So these were statements that public sector really agreed with. Our accessibility strategy helps us to meet legal and regulatory requirements pertaining to people with disabilities. So by having that strategy, it helped them meet their legal requirements. It helped them to retain employees who became temporary or permanently disabled. In employees, we think about students as well. Our accessibility strategy enables a more diverse workforce. Our accessibility strategy helps us articulate our social vision for our company. So it's all about ethos as well. Our accessibility strategy raises morale among our employees, which I think is really a cool thing. But actually, by having an effective accessibility strategy, it makes people more engaged. They feel more that they are doing a more worthwhile job as well. And finally, by addressing accessibility for people with disabilities, we can create workforce solutions to make employees without disabilities more productive. Because one of the things we think about when we're thinking about digital accessibility at a university level is we're thinking a lot about students, but we also have a lot of staff, and staff are disabled as well, and staff are getting older. So we also need to think about the benefits inside our communities as well, but this will have a positive benefit for both our staff and students. So the link is in the slide for that full report. You can go and download it, you can give it to your managers and go, look, this is actually going to help us as well. What do you think? Well, actually, you know, a bit of the academic like me, is there any basis for this? I mentioned George floated a standard 3007. This is another standard which is similar, but there's a couple of standards around. This is called Design for All standard, which has come, it's something to support the Web Accessibility Directive, which started this all off. And it's all about actually how do you design products and services to be accessible for all. And on screen, we've got a very simple project cycle. You start off with leadership, you go through a planning stage, then you design your operation services or procure, and then you monitor its effectiveness. So how do we make sure that's designed for all? Two simple steps. Leadership, you have to think about range of human abilities and needs and characteristics. Who are you actually supporting? So that means accessibility awareness within that leadership process and planning process, and thinking about environmental factors and context of use. So this morning, one of the first questions was, what was the problem with PDFs and accessibility? So if I was thinking of a project, planning a project around how are we going to produce our university prospectus online, what document format are we going to do it in? I need to think about the range of people who are going to have to interact with that. Now, that could be parents, that could be grandparents, guardians, as well as students as well. Who might have a range of digital abilities. They may have a range of disabilities and characteristics. They're more likely to be interacting with it on a mobile device, in a digital platform. And they're more likely to be doing it over a poor internet connection from home. So all those things I need to build in. But at that point, I can also say, I need to make sure it's accessible. I need to make sure that my disabled students are, and potential students are, engaged as well. And at that point, if PDF was on the list, it would probably get pushed off, because mobile and disability and accessibility is going to make it cost more. And actually, student prospectuses is one of a really, there's a lot of very poor accessible student prospectuses. If you build those objectives in, and you build them into your procurement, and you build your services correctly, you will end up, hopefully, with accessibility outcomes. You'll know what you expect at that point. You can extend the range of users, and you can also build that into your monitoring and measuring. So it's about making sure when you are planning and developing, you build it in at any point. That's top down. What about bottom up? What works? What works on the ground? And I'm sure in your panel we heard lots of examples, so I'm quickly just going to run through. Accessibility champions. As a great example, the BBC has a really good model for accessibility champions, and they talk about it. They have an approach where they train individuals who sort of apply to be an accessibility champion, give them accessibility knowledge, and then it's their duty to sort of train their peers and ensure that accessibility is considered in their meetings and their planning, and that's a really good way of developing it from the ground up. Use the expertise you have already. You've already got disabled staff and students. You know, student disabled population is 10% plus. You've got disability services. They know about assistive technology. They know about their student portals as well. And if you are doing user research, think about doing diverse user testing as well. Involve people with different disabilities and interests and experiences. I love doing user testing. You always learn so much. And I'm sure if you get somebody in who cannot use a mouse and do user testing, it will have a huge impact, not just from that accessibility point of view, but in your whole perspective of usability. Finally, think about accessibility business cases and inclusive user stories. So the GDS put up the post design posters. There's also lots of examples around on the Lexis site. You'll find personas we used in our teaching, lots of student personas, but also adults as well, which are really good design tool in getting people to understand potential accessibility needs without having to trawl through the WCAG standards, which are difficult. So final slide, is it possible for universities to achieve accessibility standards? Hands up, yes, no, yes, yeah, we've got some nodding heads. Yes, absolutely, because it's been the law in the US for a long time. The US universities have to achieve very similar accessibility standards. A lot of them get sued because of the system in the US. I've been in a US conference where, on a panel, a student got up, the guy said, this is one of my students, he sued me last year. The student got a standing ovation from disability professionals. Partly because of the way they do it, because they actually get advice, they get reports saying what they have to do to, you know, actually is supportive. It's great. It's not just a, you know, you've been sued. So, other countries have already done this. Not just the US. There are other countries. It's coming in, and Canada's had it, parts of Canada. Norway's got it. Australia are following similar regulations as well. But they recognise it requires resources and planning. Just to put this in context, Harvard was sued last year or two. They've just advertised for 8 accessibility people, 4 accessibility consultants and 4 accessibility developers. So that's the type of level resources that a big world-renowned university is looking at. And the way the US system does is the federal government come in and tell you how many people you have to employ. This is your problem. But remember, accessibility is a journey. So this is not something you are going to solve next week or maybe next year, but it's something that universities should be building in for their budgeting and to their planning in the future. It's not going to go away. And there we go.
Thank you so much.
Someone mentioned, obviously, earlier on parallels with GDPR and having the ability to kind of beat people with a stick with fines and that kind of thing. Obviously, in GDPR, you've got a DPO, so you've got someone who sits outside of, you know, all the usual processes and can kind of beat people with that stick. Do you know anyone who's used that same kind of model within the accessibility? I don't know, like an ACO or something like that? Yeah. Kind of sits there at that high enough level that they can make these things happen almost.
So, yes, so there isn't a model as such within the UK, at least. I mean, there's opportunities within these regulations for example, I believe, I think GDSL, the minister can call out, you know, if you've not got an accessibility statement there. The Office of Students are looking at how they support disabled students Access plans are something they look at. So this is all things we're sort of saying, are you going to be looking at accessibility? One of the issues with the regulations and the monitoring for students is particularly the timeline as well, that if it takes 12, 18 months for an issue to be resolved, that's a really big problem for a student. So we're very much aware of that issue and it will be pulled up. Within the monitoring system, within the regulations, the GDS is required to sort of talk to disability stakeholders as well about who to audit, who to do the spot checks. So there is another route in for groups representing disabled people and students to say, these people aren't fixing the problems, can you check them?
Hi, Abby, thank you. I love the design for all approach, and I think it's really helpful to look at it as a change management exercise, so thank you. The question I think is probably more for everybody here rather than you necessarily, although you might be able to shed some light on it. Do we know where responsibility for accessibility sits within our sector generally? If we look at the sort of senior most leader within the organisation with responsibility, where does that live?
Are you talking within an organisation or within the sector?
Within the sector, generally. What I'd like to understand is, out of all of the institutions here, where does it generally sit?
I can tell you at UCL, it's our COO, our Chief Operating Officer, and she reports to the Provost. So she is at the absolute top of the institution. And she is our disability champion. So that's great to have that. And she's in charge of all professional services, so she can bring us all together to support the whole endeavour.
Would it be possible to just get a kind of show of hands of other areas?
Yeah. So who has a sort of similar level of somebody responsible for accessibility within their organisation? COO type level? About a quarter or so.
And EDI, or that sort of area? Little handful. Yeah. Where else would it sit then? Does it sit within IT or ed tech?
Registry?
We, Alison, we've got split responsibility between COO and pro-director for education.
So split between education and operations. Yeah, I mean, this is one of the challenges of accessibility because it's content as well as technical. There was a study done, forgot to mention, by a corporate organisation who looked at WCAG standards and whose job they were, and they found that 20% were developers. Everything else was designers, content, or product owners, which basically people building requirements. So the vast majority of this is not pure coding and developers. So it needs to be seen as a cross organisation. I think outside of organisations, we're talking to you, UK, obviously JISC are involved. Trying to talk to the Department for Education. I'm involved with the school's assistive technology. They can't find somebody who owns the policy. Yeah. That's the problem. So if you know anybody who owns HEIT policy in DFA, please tell me. Because they should be communicating this down as well. As I've said, Office of Students we've been talking to. So hopefully over the next 6-12 months.
I think the student union are on the brink of doing quite a big, as in the NUS, on the brink of doing quite a big an awareness raising campaign. Yes. So, you know, institutions might be forced to take action. I think UUK would be quite a good avenue as well. I think we have to stop the questions at that point, I'm afraid, unless, was there one over there, Michelle?
So, that was kind of given the letter from the DFE to the ORFS, pushing about students' consumer rights.
Okay, sorry, that was your microphone didn't work. So this is about student consumer rights.
Which was the letter from the DFE to the ORFS this year was one of the things they came
to. Absolutely. I mean, this is, when we go back to the Equality Act, that is the Consumer Act type approach, that the relationship is consumer to business. So I think, yeah, the NUS, I know Alistair and Piers Wilkinson, who's the Disability Officer for NUS, are doing activities around this, and we expect to hear stuff in the next couple of weeks from them. So you might get your student bodies pushing back, and we're talking to A-levels and post-16 as well.
And the OIA as well.
Oh, OIA as well. We're trying to engage with them.
Office for the Independent Adjudicator.
Yeah, okay. The OIA would consider those kinds of laws when upholding student complaints, so certainly. Yeah. So the DfE letter says the OFS, consumer rights, complaint to the OIA.
Yeah. I think we need to write a blog on this.
Right, thank you, Abby. Thank you so much. Absolutely marvellous presentation.